in the Islamic religion is again a principle which is based on the notion of integrity of truth on the one hand and integrity of human personality or of human dignity on the other. Then there has been a system, there has been a social institution hallowed by many a thinker, established in many a community of the world. Patronized by many philosophers like Aristotle and Plato. The institution of serfdom and slavery. There have been numerous communities in this world. You have only to open the book Encyclopedia of Religion and Ethics, which is a classical work. You have just to open this book or any other book to find how many communities of the world have and in what manner practiced this institution, the scourge of mankind, this institution of serfdom and slavery. And then you will be able to understand the contribution which the Holy Prophet Muhammad made in this period. He laid down the law. Every human being is born free. This was, in my knowledge, was not heard ever before. You might refer to Voltaire and Rousseau. But Voltaire and Rousseau were born centuries after the Holy Prophet. And Voltaire and Rousseau had read Latin translations of his teachings and of Muslim writers, because there was a period in Europe when only Latin translation of Muslim works were taught and no other thing was taught. But this one, which echoes from that sandy waste of Arabia, which came from the mouth of that illiterate person, which came in that benighted age of mankind, when every torch of civilization which had been kindled by mankind in different parts of the world, in India and in China and in Babylonia and in Carthage and Phoenicia and Greece and Rome and Egypt and so on, when all these torches of light had been put out by the poisonous breath of bigotry and reactionism in the name of God or gods or in the name of religion and so on, when the whole world was in a state of gloom, here comes a man and stands there 1400 years ago and he proclaims every human being is born free. If every human being is born free, if every human being is born sinless and holy, naturally he should be born free. He cannot be shattered in shackles. He cannot be considered to be enchained to anything devilish or evil. This was the man in that century, the 7th century of the Christian era, who proclaimed. And when he proclaimed this, he meant what he said. he was not like some of the great politicians of this age, the great so-called leaders of different states and communities, who talk something else and mean something else and behave in some other manner. He meant what he said. And you will find in the earliest revealed portions of the Quran, revelations of the Quran, the earliest messages in the early part of his calling and his mission, you will find verses like this. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْعَقَبَةِ. How will thou understand what the difficult path of virtue is? What is the difficult path of virtue is? وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْعَقَبَةِ. Then the Quran answers, فَكُّ رَقَبَةِ. Emancipation of slaves and the abolition of this inhuman institution of slavery. Participation in this effort is the highest. Then in the same Meccan period, as the students of Islam know, that the Quran was revealed 13 years in Mecca and 10 years in Medina. Chapters which are called Meccan, there are others which are called those which were, I mean, say, Madani. That is, those which came at the time when the Holy Prophet was in Medina. Among these Meccan verses, which were the earliest, you will again find the Quran proclaiming. The Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam announcing to mankind, first of all, the distinction between formal piety and practical piety. And in practical piety, he emphasized that it is practical piety which God wants. The formal piety is hypocrisy. Unless it is joined to practical piety. And in practical piety, he enumerated what a human being has got to do. He said, the Quran says, these are the words of the Quran, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ. Spending of your wealth for the love of God, alone and not from any ulterior motive. Even not to get votes in any election to be elected as a member. By showing your philanthropy and service to the people. وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ. Only for the sake of the love of God, with the purest motive. For helping your citizens who might be in need. For helping the orphans, for helping all those who are unable to earn their living, and depend on those who are able to. For helping the tourist program of mankind that human beings may go and meet one another. For helping in establishing this, not Muslims sometimes think very wrongly that if any traveler comes, if any foreigner comes to their community, and if this poor fellow somehow he is robbed of his money or he is needy in some manner, then alone they should give him some charity as a dole. That is not the Islamic concept. The Islamic concept is to build up those institutions whereby strangers who come to the Muslim community may get all the advantages, may get all the comforts, to build for that purpose hostels, to build for that purpose all institutions whereby communication between human communities and human beings from different parts of the world may become easier and better. Opista and Pista Idi. And whoever might come to you for asking help. And for the abolition of this accursed institution of slavery. Whoever spends his wealth for this, the Quran says, the Holy Prophet announces that this is practical part. This is the party which will be rewarded by God, which will please God Almighty. In connection with this institution of slavery, I don't know why and how Islam has been maligned by the so-called Orientalists of Europe and America, by Goldfinger, by Margoliet, by Zwemer, by so on and so forth, and by their pupils in other communities. Just the other way about. What the Prophet Muhammad did was that in connection with this institution which was embedded in the economic and social life of the people, everywhere, including Arabia, he first of all made this appeal that this is the highest virtue. And may I tell you that in that sparsely populated country, it has been recorded in history that the Prophet and his followers bought the freedom of 49,000 slaves inside Arabia. Even today, Arabia has a very small population, remember this. And this number of slaves whose freedom was purchased by the Holy Prophet and by his followers, this large number tells some tale. It has been. It's not that the Holy Prophet was just a sermonizer, that he was giving to the people only sermons, or he was a visionary, or he was talking from the high pedestal of academic philosophy, or he was speaking like a poet. No. He was an idealist in the sense that he brought the highest principles of life for mankind, but he was true and true a practical man who realized what he said, who established what he said. It is said about him by a certain very uncharitable and unwise type of people that he established his state. Well, if a state is an evil institution, then all these states should vanish. What does he mean? He should have remained a mendicant. He should have remained a so-called recluse type of holy man, just begging so and so and so and so, would you please come to the right path? This is not the way of reforming mankind. This is not the way of setting an example. This is not the way of establishing goodness and virtue. Exhortation must follow by example. And the example has got to be set. So he had to set the example of what an ideal state can be and should be. What type of state he wants. When he established the state, he laid down the principle of taxation. As no state can run without a scheme in that scheme of taxation, he established, he laid down one tax, which, to my knowledge, nobody has had used this term before. He called it the social welfare tax. On 2.5% of the capital which a person owns, or the capital goods that he owns. Year after year, this has got to be paid, and anybody, he said, who is not prepared to pay it, ipso facto goes out of the fold. Then he laid down the items on which this social insurance tax was to be spent. And do you know that among these items was one item which was made the obligation of the Muslim state, that at least one eighth part of that accumulated tax, the Muslim state was duty bound to spend for striving for the abolition of slavery from the world. Read the verse of the Quran. إنما الصدقات للفقراء والمساكين والعاملين عليها والمؤلفة قلوبهم وفي الرقاب والغارمين وفي الرقاب. Any message from anyone? وفي الرقاب. For the emancipation of slaves and for the abolition of this institution. Ladies and gentlemen, you may go on studying the different principles of Islam. Islam is a coherent scientific code of life. It is not haphazard. It is a coherent system where one principle follows another in logical sequence. Look at Islam from any point of view. From any point of view, it might take me the whole night, it might take me the exposition of entire Islam. Look at the Muslim form of worship. How do they worship? You can, any one of you can go and say, those who are my non-Muslim brothers and sisters, they can go. At no period of Muslim history could this sin be committed by Muslims. We consider it a sin, and so I am saying it on behalf of Islam, that any distinction could be made inside the mosque for having certain places reserved for any particular person. This is considered to be the greatest sin in Islam because it violates human dignity. According to Islam, the prince and the pageant, the ruler and the subject, the wealthy man and the pauper, and a person belonging to any race or any color or any country, they are all equal in the sight of God. And when they come to worship that God, wherever a person finds his place, he should stand up there. It is prohibited for any Muslim to walk over the heads of other Muslims and to try to go and take place in the first row. Even in modern times, when Muslims are not what they ought to have been, Prime Minister Liaquat Ali Khan, the founder of Pakistan, Qaid-e-Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah, so many times people saw them worshipping outside the mosque, on the road, by the gutter, because they were late in coming and the mosque was full. idea of the Muhammadani Jinnah, who was held in the highest esteem as the founder and father of Pakistan, and who was the head of the state of Pakistan, I have seen it. Many more people have seen it. Then coming on Friday congregational prayers, he would simply come and his bodyguards would stretch out the prayer mat on the road, because there was no place inside. This is what in Islam has been termed, what the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has taught in connection with human dignity. He said, he taught us. He said that the Islamic community stands for spiritual democracy, because Islam does not sanction any Christian. According to Islam, there can be no intermediary between man and God. Islam does not. Any Muslim who is more learned and more pious than the others, he should be asked and can be asked to lead the congregation, not as a priest. Mind you, I am not a priest. I'll go immediately out of the fold of Islam the moment I consider myself or anybody considers me to be a Christian. Yes, that was me. And I endorse it. We cannot. This is the principle of spiritual democracy. Islam has not placed the necks of human beings in the hands of other human beings, even on spiritual considerations. Then Islam is social democracy. The high and the low. In whatever manner you might conceive them to be, are equal in the eyes of God, and the only principle of superiority that Islam acknowledges is Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. He who is better in his conduct and character, he who is purer, sublimer in his character, he is more honorable than a person who is not there. Otherwise, Islam does not recognize any distinction whatsoever. This is Islam's social democracy. Then Islam gave to the world the concept of political democracy. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam declared, to call any person, to give the title to any person, the title of king, is an insult to God, because he alone is the king. And he gave the principle in politics that the state should be under the sovereignty of God, for the people, by the people. That was the formula that he gave. And he had taken away sovereignty from the people, which was emphasized by Abraham Lincoln and the Constitution of the United States. Government of the people, by the people, for the people. This notion the Prophet did not. He said, once you say that you are placing sovereignty in the hands of the people, which people? Only a section. The rulers who will rule, or the party which will rule, sovereignty will, for that, in that period, will be in their hands. So he said, sovereignty cannot be placed in the hands of any human being. It only belongs to God. And so he gave the notion, in order to protect human dignity, he gives the principle that the Islamic state or the Islamic government is government of God, by the people, for the people. But he laid the foundations of democracy. He would behave himself. He was the spiritual leader. He ruled the hearts of the people. And may I tell you how he ruled the heart? Just one. When he would perform his ablution, when he would wash his face, people would run, men and women, to fetch the water before it dropped on the earth. They were mad in love for him. He could enjoy any amount of worship or respect from the people. He had a very gracious personality, a very beautiful and very magnificent personality. And when people would come before him, sometimes they would start trembling. The magnetism of his personality would overawe them. And he would stand up and greet them, "My dear brothers," he would say smilingly, "I am the son of Amina and Abdullah. I am a human. I am your brother. Would you kindly take your seat?" That was the humanity. That was the principle that he inculcated in the hearts of his followers, that human dignity is inviolable. Is inviolable. And I may give you one instance from his life. Again, from that you will understand what was the message that he gave and how he put it into real practical norms, into real practical forms. When he was about to leave this earthly sea, he was sick. The sickness prior to his demise. So he assembled all the people of Medina, the capital of the state. All the people of Medina were invited that today Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wassalam wants to have a talk with all the people. So they came. Then this great man, in spite of his sickness, he stood up with his staff in his hands. And he said, "Dear Muslims," there was only Muslim population there and no other, "dear Muslims, I know you love me. I know that you have got to honor me very highly as God has commanded. But I am shortly going to leave this earthly sea. I wish to find out from every one of you if I ever did any wrong to anyone. I am here to be there for that wrong to be avenged on me." Remember, he was speaking to his followers. "I have not read about any leader, I have not known any leader in the entire history of mankind who could behave like this." Of course, that was his greatness, but at the same time, it was his regard for the principle of human dignity. As he spoke, a gentleman arose and he said, "Yes, O Prophet, O our leader, you once touched me with a stick, and I wish to avenge that." This greatest of all leaders in human history bowed his head. He said, "Here is here is the stick." He said, "But not in this manner.